I jokingly said at the beginning, if only we had this facility in the classroom. Wouldn't this be great? Just mute everyone and then we can get on. Not really. It's really nice having the children back at school this week and seeing them all. And it's lovely to see all of you this morning. Welcome to our Mothering Sunday service, the official title. I did do a little bit of research. Some of you will probably know that Mothering Sunday started way back in the 16th century with people returning to their mother church on the fourth Sunday of Lent. Then it sort of evolved into girls in service going home, taking flowers to their mum one day a year off. And then it all stopped. And I didn't know that. So I don't, that was known to the rest of you. And it didn't start up again until around 1920s, around that time. And that it was Mother's Day. And then we linked it to Mothering Sunday. So in some countries, Mother's Day is in May. But in our country, it's still linked with Mothering Sunday, a time when we can say thank you to those people that care for us, whether it's our mothers or others. So welcome to this service. I hope the children have all got their little bag. I've got mine, and that you've been starting to investigate it, but also be aware we will be coming back to that during the course of our service. So without any more chat from me, we are going to start with our opening song of praise. Now, this song was introduced to us by Peter Nichols a couple of weeks ago. I just love it because it's really upbeat. It's got some lovely fireworks going off in the background. It's a great celebration of God's love. And children, if you don't know it, don't worry. Just get up and have a dance, because it's the sort of song you can have a little dance to, and the grown-ups will do the grown-up bit and sing the words. Okay, Adrian, if we can have our opening song of praise, Magnificent, Marvellous, Matchless Love. Do you need me to talk a bit longer? Oh. Just talk amongst yourselves for a moment.
I'm screen sharing.
It has been busy cooking salmon and things. So, you know, it's a busy morning.
Let me just try that again.
Sorry. That's all right. It's nice to see the expert needs to think twice.
Forever existing in worlds above, now offered and given to all. Oh, fountain of beauty eternal, the Father, the Spirit, the Son, sufficient and endlessly generous, magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. You crown every meadow with color. You paint it. anything sever or take us from. Magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. How great, how sure his love and joy.
Thanks, Adrian. What a great song that is. Just a reminder that we've got God's marvellous, magnificent, matchless love available to us all. And so we're going to start us carry on with our service now. And Sarah's going to open in prayer for us. You're muted, Sarah.
If you can join me by saying the words in bold as we pray together. God, creator and parent of all, we come to worship you. God, you nourished and rescued your people. We come to worship you. God, you care for us like a mother. We come to worship you. God, you give strength and love to all who care for children. We come to worship you. God, you support us in good times and hard times. We come to worship you. Help us to listen to the story of your saving love, to share in your love, and to be carriers of that love to all your people. And we ask this in the name of Jesus, your Son. Amen.
Amen.
And just a little prayer for those people who have been involved in putting this service together for us this morning. Lord, we want to thank you for those who've been involved in bringing this service to this point. For all those who have helped with communication and preparation and delivering the bags and planning. And now, Lord, we are here. And as we gather to meet with you, please will you be with Bev especially as she leads us. May she know your presence with her, so she may help us to know your presence with us too. In your name, amen.
Thank you, Sarah. Now we're coming to a time in our service that we regularly have. It's called confession. It's a big word. I'll just wait for Adrian to move the screen on. Okay, so confession's just this. Who here has done absolutely nothing wrong this week? None of us can say that, can we? All of us get it wrong occasionally. Probably more than occasionally. Most days there are times when we do or say things that we really wish we hadn't have done. But thankfully, we can come to God because of what Jesus did on the cross, and we can say sorry. And that's what we're going to do now. And as we say these words, we can be sure that God will forgive us because his word tells us that he does. So let's read these words together now. Father God, we are sorry for the things we do and say and think which make you sad, and for not thinking of others before ourselves. Please forgive us. Help us to love you and other people more and more. Amen. Thank you. Now Adrian's going to read our Bible reading for us. Thank you, Adrian.
Mute myself. Okay. So Exodus 2:1-10. So the story of Moses as a baby. Now, a man of the tribe of Levi married a Levite woman, and she became pregnant and gave birth to a son. When she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and coated it with tar and pitch. Then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile, the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. Then Pharaoh's daughter went down to the Nile to bathe, and her attendants were walking along the riverbank. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her female slave to get it. She opened it and saw the baby. He was crying, and she felt sorry for him. "This is one of the Hebrew babies," she said. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" "Yes, go," she answered. So the girl went and got the baby's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this baby and nurse him for me, and I will pay you." So the woman took the baby and nursed him. When the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses, saying, "I drew him out of the water."
Thanks, Adrian. Over to Lynn now.
Okay, everybody. Hello. Lovely to see you all. And I see that some people had already been waving their pipe cleaner around. So I know you're ready to start making our Moses basket. So I hope you've got everything ready that you had on your list. And you've got all excellent, good. And you've got it all laid out, just like I have here next to me, ready. Now, this is a bit tricky doing it on Zoom because obviously I can't see what you're doing most of the time. And Bev is going to do a talk after this. So don't panic if you get a little bit behind, okay? Hopefully you'll be able to keep up, and I'll go slowly, but I can't go too slowly. So are we ready? So the first thing you will need is your little envelope and your scissors. Oh, lovely. It's good when people wave things. So you need to get your envelope. And you can see the bendy bit. We're going to cut across there, okay? So I'm just going to cut the flappy bit off at the top, okay? I hope you can see that. We don't need that anymore, all right? So I've got Katie and Kaylee cutting, which is, I can see them on my screen, so that's helpful. So have you cut that bit off, girls? Yeah, you're cutting the flap off. Yeah, the little flap at the top. So you don't want that anymore. Okay, that's going to go. Right. I think this next bit is the trickiest bit. And we did put a little picture on your leaflet if you do get a bit stuck. So I draw one for you. Your envelope should look like this now. Okay. No flap. And with a pencil, you need to be able to put some dots on. And so what I've done is where the little bit comes up here and curves, if you put a dot with a pen or a pencil just there, and then a dot opposite at the top. Okay, yeah, that's it. You've cut it beautifully. Yeah, now we're going to do the dots. Okay, and then we're going to do a dot halfway down, just a little bit of a way down here, and a little bit of a way down there. So you've got four dots. Because what we want to do, and I say this is probably the hardest bit of all of it, is that we want to draw, like the dots are there to help us to draw a shape. Yeah, that's good. That's lovely. I don't know if that's Kadia or Kaylee, but that's lovely. And now we want to draw like an eye to join those dots up. Excellent. That's it. Can you draw a sort of eye shape? Have a go. Do it with a pencil. See if you can draw an eye shape like that. That's what we're after. Okay, that's it. That's excellent. Jolly good. That's just the job. Oh, you're very good at this. Now comes the very hardest bit. So listen very carefully. I shall say this only once. I probably won't. That's for mums and dads. I should probably say it more than once. But now, this is the really tricky bit. Okay. Because what we want to end up with, and I've got a bigger one here I did earlier, we want to end up with this piece as our basket. And you can see we've still got the curve bit at the top, but the inside bit we've cut. Now, if you do it wrong, which I hope nobody's going to do, if you cut on those green lines, you will end up with, not like that, you'll end up with a basket shape, but nothing at the top. And we don't want that. So what you need to do is, first of all, you can cut along that top bit of the eye, only the top bit. So we get a lovely curved top to it. So if you can do that first, cut along that top bit of the eye. Okay, so you're going from this dot here, carefully across the top, to that dot there, so you get a lovely curved top to your envelope. Only that top bit, okay? And this is the trickiest bit, so I hope your grown-ups are helping you. And if they say cut the bottom bit, tell them no. So we have to do something special first before we cut that bit. That's looking good. That's it, girls. Well done. Yeah, and I'm sure wonderful. Now, what we need to do, and I'll use my bigger one just to show you, you need to put your hand inside so that you aren't going to cut through both layers of the envelope. So if I put my hand inside there, I can see the green, but I'll turn it that way. Can you see our bottom green line? So we want to cut from side to side, but with our hand inside, so we don't accidentally cut right through the whole envelope. Otherwise, we'll cut that bit off and we want that bit. So the best way I thought of describing it is to say, if you put your fingers inside, but you have to be very careful to cut the fingers, and then you can just cut, oh, this one hasn't got the top cut off, let me cut my top off. Right, so there we are. So I'm going to put my fingers inside like that, and then I'm going to cut from the side across. And can you see I'm going across just that layer? This bit is still behind me because my fingers are in the way. It's a bit hard for me to cut that way around and show you at the same time, but you can see what I'm doing. My hand's in the way, so I can't cut that back piece. So I should end up with that shape. And that's where that's the hardest bit. I hope I've explained it well enough. So if you get your fingers in there, then that should stop you from cutting the whole top bit off as well. If you're not sure, ask your grown-up to help you. Double check. Okay, so that's the very hardest bit. So I'm going to look now and flip across my screen and see if you're holding them up. Brilliant. Yeah, that's looking good. So if you wave them at me. Everybody hold them up so I can see. I'm having a look across the screen now. Yeah, that's looking good. Oh, yeah. Oh, brilliant. You're marvellous. Oh, well done, Kathy. Excellent. That's great. So everybody happy with that, I hope. Okay, let me go back across my screen. Let me see four of you at once. Wonderful. So that's the hardest bit. We can all take a big relaxing breath now. We've done that bit. Now, the next bit's quite an easy bit. I'm going to use my big envelope to show you. You just need to fold the corner up. You can draw a little dotted line across if you like, if that helps you, as I've done there. Just drawn a little tiny dotted line across the corner, and then I'm just going to fold it back out of the way and put a little bit of sellotape or glue on it. Okay, so that is just to make the edge look a bit more baskety shaped, I guess. Okay, so you can do that bit. That's not at all difficult. And then the next bit is the where you need your pipe cleaner. And you're going to put a little bit of sellotape across the end of the pipe cleaner, just across the end there. And then you can tuck it inside and sellotape it down both sides. So now you've got your basket handle. So push it against the edge and tuck it in. If you've got glue, that would be fine. Okay, so that's what we should be ending up with. Okay, everybody busy doing that? Excellent. Yep. I found Sellotape worked best because I've got a Prit stick, but Prit stick's not always good for sticking things unless they're all paper. So Sellotape seems to work really well. So your little corners, Sellotaped at the back, and your handle, Sellotaped like that. Some of the pipe cleaners are quite long, so you can just push them down a bit if you think it's too long a handle. Okay. Now, while you're doing that, I'll talk you through the next bit. Okay. Because this is where we come to the baby. So you find your lolly stick. I've got a slightly different one to you here. And you're just going to draw a nice smiley little face on your baby. At least I hope it's going to be a smiley face. I suppose Moses might have been a bit sad when he was in that basket to start with. I wonder where he was going. But I've got a little smiley face on my baby. And then because we want to keep baby Moses warm, we can find a bit of our tissue. You might need to fold that up and tear it and make it a bit smaller. And then I'm going to wrap baby Moses in there, tuck him up so he's all cuddled up in the bit of tissue. Okay, now I know some of you will still be sellotaping, but I hope you've sort of got an ear to what I'm doing as well. Okay, so that's baby Moses. And then, of course, we don't want to leave our basket looking all bare and white. So I know you've got crayons at the ready and coloured pencils and felt pens. So what I did with mine is I got a felt pen and went round the edges to make those really stand out. And then just to give it that feeling of a basket, I've just drawn some lines going down. And if you curve them a little bit, that makes them look as though it's following the lines, the curve of the basket. And then I've just done some little lines across. And then I've used my orange and brown pencils to colour in, going side to side to make it look like sort of basket weave. Okay, that doesn't have to be exact, it just gives you the feeling of a basket. You see, everyone is so busy, concentrating so hard. Well done. And when you've got to that bit, it's quite simple then, because you just need to open up your little basket. You should have been given some more tissue, which you can sort of scrunch up and pop in there. And actually what I did was made a little hole in my tissue. And then I popped baby Moses, sort of in that and scrunched that round him a bit. So that when I popped him in the basket, you can play about with your tissue till you feel happy with it. Oops, that's the end of my... And then there he is in his basket. And so you can fluff your tissue up till you're happy with it. It's a bit hard doing it with two hands in front of a camera. But you get the idea. So that should be baby Moses all cuddled up in his blanket. In his basket. So I hope everybody's got that. If you haven't got that far, don't worry, but I hope that means you know exactly what you've got to do, and perhaps in a little while we'll be able to have everybody holding them up and showing them there. That would be nice.
Well, I wondered if we could do that, Lynn, at the end of the talk, otherwise I'm a bit worried we're going to run over. So if the children would like to carry on now doing those and the other things that are in their basket, and thank you, Lynn, for demonstrating that so carefully for us. I'll just move into the reflections on our story, that our aim mostly at the grown-ups, so children do take this time to just enjoy making your basket and finishing the little things that are in your bag, the cards and the bookmark for mummy. And thank you, Lynn. So this is a well-known story, obviously, of Moses in the bulrushes. And the children might have been wondering, why on earth was his mummy hiding him? Well, the reason she was hiding him was because Pharaoh was trying to reduce the population of the Hebrews in Egypt. He was worried that they were getting too many and that they would take over. This has been an issue, obviously, through the centuries of people worrying about foreigners taking over. And there it is in the Bible right back there. And so his mom had to hide him because otherwise he would have been killed. They were killing the babies as soon as they were born. Very, very sad. So his mum hid him, and then he got too big to hide in the house anymore. And so then we have what Adrian read to us. So it's a well-known account of Moses in the bulrushes. It's actually a rags-to-riches story. Moses goes on to be Pharaoh's son, but also back again. He ended up having to leave Egypt, but many of you will know that story. And I just wanted to think, what can we take from this today? How did God fulfill his purposes for this small baby? We all know that Moses went on to lead his people, lead God's people out of Egypt, out of slavery. So how did God fulfill that? Moses could have been killed as a small child, as a baby, but he wasn't. Is it a miracle that he was allowed to stay alive? Maybe a little bit of a one. I'm not sure how anybody keeps a small baby from crying or anybody hearing it. So a bit of a miracle. But also what this story is showing us is that the people in Moses's life at that time, God used them to keep him safe. So who was it that we've met? There was his mum. She risked her life by holding on to her child and hiding him. She also used her creativity. You're making a little basket out of paper. She made one out of bulrushes. Amazing. I don't know where to start doing something like that. But she used what she had. She used what she could do. And she also trusted God. She put her child into that basket and floated him on the river. And then there was his sister, Miriam. She did what she could do. She was very brave. She hid and she watched. But she was also very wise and quick thinking. The minute she realized that she could step in and help her brother even more, she certainly did. And then there's Pharaoh's daughter. Here was a foreigner. Here was someone that her father was trying to get rid of. But she loved him. And she offered him what she had, a home. She was prepared to go against the tide. She was prepared to take a risk. But then in steps Miriam and offers this amazing way out, enabling Moses to return to his family for at least a little while. All those people in the story this morning were motivated by love. Love for Moses. What does that mean for us today, though? Well, I think we're called to be channels of God's love this morning. Teresa of Avila, I think that's how you pronounce it, said this: because Jesus is no longer here with us, she reminded us that our eyes are the eyes through which he looks with compassion on this world. Ours are the feet with which he walks to do good, and ours are the hands through which he blesses all the world. More recently, Mother Teresa said, not all of us can do great things, but we can do small things with great love. We need to be motivated by love for those around us. Jesus said, love your neighbour, but also motivated by love for God. That causes us to go out and reach out to people. C.S. Lewis said, miracles do happen, but they're extremely rare, i.e. the supernatural movement of God is rare, but every day we actually have opportunities to show God's love to others through ordinary, everyday encounters we have. In the Bible, one of Jesus' followers, John, said, let's not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. Moses' mother was self-sacrificing. She used her creativity. She used what she could do, and she was rewarded. She got her son back for a while. Miriam had to be brave and patient, but also quick thinking. The skills she had, God used to protect her brother. And Pharaoh's daughter, she showed compassion. She showed compassion to the stranger, to the outcast. And she shared what she had. We're called to do the same. If we listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit and we're obedient, we're invited to partner with God in bringing about his purposes for others as well as ourselves. Just this morning, as I was doing my own private devotion, God showed me a verse through my readings. It was nothing, you know, it wasn't a voice from heaven or anything. It was through my readings. And I was so encouraged by this. In Hosea 11, verse 4, God says about the nation Israel that he drew them with cords of human kindness and ties of love. Human kindness. What an encouragement that God uses us to bring about his purposes. During this week, let's all be looking out for opportunities to share love and kindness. Let's spend time in our Father's presence so he can guide and direct us through his word, and listen for those promptings of the Holy Spirit. Could be something very, very simple, and often is, that God's calling us to do, to bless others and to show his love to them. And finally, just a final thought. Moses was a baby. He could only accept what others did for him. He had no say in what happened. And sometimes we all really struggle to accept help from others. It's hard. But as our next song reminds us, by doing that, we can also bless others. I hope these few thoughts have been helpful, and that you'll have time to think on them during the rest of today. And just before we sing our song, children, do you want to hold up your baskets so we can all see how you've got on? Maybe Adrian could make the, could we have the, if it's not too much trouble, Adrian, because I know it's more difficult. Oh, they're holding them up now. That's wonderful. They've done so well. Well done, children. So this little story.
This is mine.
They're great. Those baskets you can keep this week and be looking at and remembering that God can use you to bring kindness and love to other people too, just as he used Moses' sister. Thank you, children. You can switch your, mute yourself now, I think Adrian will, and we'll move into our song. Brother, sister, let me serve you.
Yeah.
Now Lynn is going to lead us in our prayers, and children, you might want to take part because I know she's got some actions for you as well to do as she's doing the prayers.
Okay, yes, I hope all of you would like to join in with the actions. First of all, a prayer just to listen to. Loving Father, to those of us who have been granted the gift of being mothers and grandmothers, let us not forget those for whom Mothering Sunday is a difficult day rather than a celebration. We pray for those who may long for or have longed for children who are denied this experience. May they find fulfillment through knowing your love. We pray too for those who have never known their mother or whose mothers have died. We remember all mothers who share in Mary's suffering of witnessing their child's death. We pray for those who struggle with the way their children have chosen to live their lives. And we pray for those who have a difficult relationship with their mother. Heavenly Father, bless them with your love. May they have the comfort of knowing that your love for them is constant, your understanding perfect, your compassion never ending. Loving God, we give you thanks for all who care for us, who encourage us and help us grow. Amen. Okay, everybody, so you will just need your hands, mostly. And I'm going to read the first bit of the line, and then there's a little action that you can perhaps join in. So are you ready? You can pop your baskets down for a minute. Okay, so here we go. Thank you, God, for our mums. Thank you, God, that our mums are stars. Twinkly stars. Help us to give our mums a helping hand. We pray that you will bless all mums. Thank you, mums, that our mums are great. And if you want to jump up as well as do the thumbs up, you can. Thank you, mum. Thank you, God, that our mums are smart. Thank you, God, that they love us. And we love them with all our heart. We need to remember other people who look after us, like our teachers and our friends and people who help us with our hobbies, and remind ourselves too that God loves us. So can you say with me, thank you, God, and then I'll follow the sentence with the actions that you can join in with. Okay, so you're going to say thank you, God, and join in with the action. Put your hand on your heart. Thank you, God, that you love each one of us. Wrap your arms around yourself. Thank you, God, for the love of mothers, past and present, and still to come. Thank you, God, for homes and help those who don't feel safe today. Thank you, God, for all the people who work to take care of us every day. Thank you, God, for your love. Keep us close to your love each day. Amen.
Thank you, Lynn. It's a lovely way to do our prayers, joining in and taking part ourselves, which is always super. Now, we are nearly there. And I know you'll be very disappointed because we've had such fun this morning, but we are going to sing a song that just reminds us of what I was talking about in my talk. If you were listening, children, but also grown-ups, hopefully you were listening. In my talk, I was talking about the fact that God uses us to reach other people. He calls us to shine like stars in the darkness. And so we're going to sing a great song that's called Shine. Do hold on for a bit. There's a the shine word comes up, but it doesn't start until you hear the people singing. And I'm going to try and do the actions, but I'm going to sit here so there won't be, it won't be me jumping up and down, so you can actually see them and join in if you'd like to. So shine from the inside out.
That the world will see you live in me. Shine from the inside out. That the world will see you live in me. You know me and you love me. You feel me, so send me to shine from the inside out. That the world will see you live in me. Shine inside out, that the world will see you live in me. Shine from the inside out, that the world will see you live in me. Shine from the inside out, that the world will see you live in me. Send me, know me, love me, feel me, send me. Oh, know me, love me, feel me, send me. To shine from the inside out, that the world will see you live in me. Shine from the inside out, that the world will see you live in me. You know me. Send me, know me, love me, feel me, send me. Know me, love me, feel me, send me. To shine.
Well done, everyone. I hope you really enjoyed that song, that you'll remember that during this day and through this week, that we're called to shine for Jesus. And we're going to finish with this final prayer, which I invite you to join me with in, join with me in saying together. I'm just going to hold for a moment while you just look at those words and consider if you can say this with me this morning. Father, help me to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help me to give myself away to others, being kind to everyone I meet. Spirit, help me to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all I do and say. Amen. Thank you, Adrian. Thank you to everyone that's taken part this morning. Thank you to all of you for coming, because I would have felt very silly doing this all on my own. So thank you all for coming. Thank you for joining in. I hope what you've heard today has been helpful and will bless you for the rest of this day and this week. It's now time for us to go and grab a coffee. Go and get that cake that you've made for Mum. I'm sure you've got one. And if not, Mum, just so you know, in case they've hidden it, there are two chocolates in here just for you, not for the children. Okay, go and grab a coffee, a cake, whatever it is you've got. And we're going to meet back here in about, five minutes. Right.
And then we can break out into smaller rooms and enjoy a coffee and a chat for another 5 minutes. Okay, see you soon.
Thanks, Adrian, for leading
us. Thank you, Bev. That was awesome. and some great demonstrating of basket making with Lynn.
Oh, amazing. I hope all the grown-ups are going to go off and make their own now.
And people might want to show their baskets off, might want to show us the any Mothering Sunday cards that they've made.
Yeah, all the things you've made, bring them to the...
Anything else that they've done for mums, be lovely to see it.
Okay. That'd be great.
Cool. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. See you soon.